class in power, the Chinese communists, did not forget the peasant contribution to the victory. In any case, their post-liberation, to use the official term in China today, the post-49 dealing with peasants, initially remained in stark contrast with those of the early Soviet government under Lenin. The 1950 agrarian reform distributed land, confiscated from landlords and rich peasants by the government, and distributed among some 300 million peasants. In 1917, the Mujik had themselves seized the land of the landlord. In 1950, the communists gave the land to the landlord. And the peasants were so thankful for the gift that they came to identify communist revolution with the sharing of land. The famous phrase in China at the time was Ni Fan Shang Ma, which means did you turn your body? The turn your body meant in official language, did you make revolution? For peasants, that was equivalent to did you receive your share of the land? And Ni Fan Shang Ma, did you make revolution? Was did you get your share of the land? That was revolution. Not only were peasants initially thankful to their leaders, but the leaders themselves remained much better disposed towards the peasants than the Bolsheviks had been towards the Mujik. Even later, during the Great Leap Forward, Mao said he understood those peasants who concealed their crop in order to escape grain collection. This amounted, he said himself, to legitimate self-defense. The penny says that he meant what he said, in contrast to Stalin, when he wrote his famous article dizzy with success in March 2nd, 1913, the Pravda. Confronted with peasant resistance to collectivization and equalization, Stalin had no choice but to retreat, and he hastened to accuse his underling of his own misdeeds, so as to transfer his responsibilities onto the shoulders of local officials. Mao was sincere, if never consistent nor effective, when he sympathized with those peasants who hiding the grain from his own officials. He says or defending their class interests, and as well as later when he laments over the poor quality of rural schools and sanitary institutions, and Mao himself, on top of his regime, would say, in our country, under socialists, good hospitals and universities remain the privilege of urban lords. And the poor peasants are always second-class citizens or even worse. Even though he did not remedy such blatant inequality, he at least reduced both death rate and analphabetism rates, and mon village Chevron, he did so with greater fervor and more efficiently than the Soviet had done before him. So, even when he expelled from the cities those educated youth, the famous judging, people, it's like they finish high school about that, in the cities. And so when he expelled them after having mobilized them against the party headquarters in the early phase of the Cultural Revolution, he no doubt wanted to get rid of them, but he still added himself. He still added those educated youth. Judging Chinese was to be re-educated by honest, hard-working, unselfish peasants. And no longer claiming here that he was still sincere, but simply such an idea would never have come to the mind of Stalin. So now, the third part, in spite of the contrast, similar murderous politics. The same Mao was personally responsible for the tragedy that befell on Chinese peasant, more than anyone else among the Chinese leadership. So in the last part of my presentation, I will try to solve sad paradox, whereas the Chinese communist feelings toward and relationships with présent un far closer than the developing tools of the Soviet predecessor, they, and now especially, ended up inflicting no less distress, misery, torment, than death and present. And subdivides this third and last part into three moments, quick I go. First, the peasant policies of Chinese communists were basically the same as those of the Soviet model. Both revolutionary regimes attempted to industrialize, modernize, socialize the country at utmost speed, while having that colossal enterprise financed by peasants working like slaves with a primitive socialist accumulation of bureaucracy. The Chinese communists felt twice the pressure of a superego, that of Marxist ideology, that of the Soviet, Stalinist Soviet model. And once in power, they are said to impose compulsory collection of grain as early as the fall of 53. That means at the very beginning, because from 1949-52, they had to consolidate their power, fight inflation, there was the Korean War, and they could not do nothing else at the preliminary works. And then accelerated relativization as early as 1955. That's very excessive at most speed. In our world, they socialized agriculture earlier than the Soviet had done, and at a greater speed in 10 months from the summer of 1955 to the spring of 56, no less than 91% of the peasant households were socialized, and the same feast required at least from 1929 to the fall of 41 in the Soviet Union, of course, with the retreat after the Disease Success episode. Their model was the second Soviet Revolution, following the great turning point. They copied, imitated Stalin's strategy of development rather than the whole Soviet experience. When socializing, they used similar tactics and to induce peasants to join the newly established collectives, which are called at the beginning cooperatives, and later, as you know, People's Commune. Back in 1930, some Soviet activists or officials would ask peasants, who is against the Kolkhoz, or were more direct, who is against Soviet power? And when nobody raised a hand, they considered that the villagers had unanimously expressed their will to become Kolkhoznik. 25 years later, in Hovei village, in 1955, communist cadres set two tables on the main road of the village and explained to the villagers there were two ways, that of socialism, that of capitalism. You can choose either way. For socialists, seeing at this table. And later on, the Great Leap predicated the Soviet First 5 year plan. One may object that now was by then dissatisfied with the model, the Soviet model, and he claimed to open an original Chinese way, symbolized by the famous two legs, one spending scarce capital and imported technology, and the other relying on China's inexhaustible manpower. But I do not agree with that view. No, I'm sincere, I think that, but Mao did not flee insane from the heart of Stalin's strategy, namely the overriding priority of heavy industry. And as a matter of fact, investment in heavy industry became even more exaggerated during the Great Leap than there had been during the first 5 year plan. And the target of steel production more than doubled, increased more than twofold within a single year in 1950. So I just mentioned now, rather than the collective Chinese leadership at least, named second moment in the last part, namely Mao personal involvement and responsibility for most causes of acceleration, not to mention leaps. No Chinese leader was against socializing agriculture, or something. They were all in favor. But most of them, in the early 50s, beginning with Xiaoxin, number two, thought that It could not be initiated on that path. It was impossible given the state of Chinese economy and society, and that it would require a long time to be implemented once we could begin. In November, when there was no disagreement over the ultimate goal, there was serious divergence over the pace required to achieve it. So the concept of new democracy, devised by Mao in a small booklet published in 1914, had worked out very well as a propagandist slogan. But as soon as the preliminary task I was mentioning at the beginning of fighting remaining enemies, unifying the country, taming inflation and so on, had been completed by 1952, an impatient Mao tried and speed up the turn from new democracy to full-scale socializing. He imposed it to the leadership. In 1955, it was Mao's idea to accelerate collectivization, and he imposed his choice against explicit objection expressed by none other than the communist leader Deng Zhurui, who was at the time the communist leader in charge of the rural department of the Central Committee. That means number one responsible for peasant affairs. And in fact, of course, he was demoted when he was still maintaining his objection. The thing that again, this has been studied by Frederick Thiels and Warren Soon in a book called The Politics of Agricultural Collectivization in China. But again, later on, in 1958, he had managed in the way to come back, and he again incurred the Mao's because he still was in favor of more moderate policies. So later on, Mao's personal responsibility for launching the Great Leap, for restarting it after the Lushan meeting, is firmly established and did not recapitulate every single radical initiative taken by Mao from the end of the famine until his death. And simply point out the dual origin of this Mao's initiative. I just use the term radical. One origin is indeed to be found in Mao's radicalism, in other words, his radical conviction and choice. The increasingly made him censure his more pragmatic lieutenants. On the other hand, when he took revenge when the royal leader, when Liu Shaoqi and over, when he launched the Cultural Revolution, his conviction mattered less than the despot's whims. He was both vindictive and eager to preserve and regain his supreme absolute power. And I think this motive became prominent more and more.